Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming down for our Saturday STEM seminar today. My name is Emily Meyer. I'm the STEM program manager here at Science City. And today I am very excited to introduce you to Dr. Emily Arnold. She is an assistant professor at KU and the graduate director for the Aerospace Engineering Department up at KU. She's been a speaker for me before for some of our other programs. She's had and led workshops for some of our student programs. So I'm greatly appreciative that she is back here to do another seminar for you guys today. It's going to be a great one. So without further ado, Dr. Emily Arnold.
All right, good morning. Thank you, Emily, for that introduction. As she mentioned, I'm a professor in aerospace engineering at the University of Kansas. And so today, I'm excited to sort of have an opportunity to tell you a little bit about my journey to becoming an aerospace engineer. We'll also talk about a little bit about what the heck an aerospace engineer is and what they do. And then I'm going to share with you some of my research. My research has taken me literally to the edges of this planet. And so I think sort of what I do is cool, and I love to share it with folks. So to begin, I think you might need to click on my presentation, maybe hit play. Okay, so tell you a little bit about myself. I grew up in a very small town in South Central Kansas. It's only about a square mile big. I have a population of 3,000 on there. I don't even think it's that anymore. But the point being, growing up, I was not exposed to engineering. There was no large engineering firms nearby. Wichita is about an hour away, so you get a little bit of news coming out of Wichita. But by and large, most of the folks that I knew were teachers and farmers, which are all great professions. But the point being, I didn't really know what an engineer was. I remember someone once telling me that they were an engineer, and later I found out that they were a train engineer, meaning they drove the train, which is very different than the type of engineer I am. So growing up, like I said, wasn't exposed a lot to engineering, but what I did know is that I absolutely loved and was fascinated by all things above me. So spacecraft, aircraft, I always looked up into the night sky at night and looking at the stars and sort of wondering what it is that's going up there and how cool it would be to design things that would someday get to fly in the sky. In addition to that, around my high school days, I realized that I really, really loved math and that I was okay at it. For me, English was never my thing. You know, in English, we have rules, and then there's exceptions for rules, and then exceptions for exceptions to the rules for how to spell words. And for me, that just didn't make any sense. That didn't jive with who I was. And I just absolutely loved the pure logic of math. You could logic your way through any problem, and I just love sort of that set and defined way about things. So in high school, I started realizing I had these interests, maybe these passions. And so I was trying to figure out, like, what could I do with these? And so I remember talking to a guidance counselor, and she had mentioned something about aerospace engineering. So I started looking into what does an aerospace engineer do. So I want to take a moment to kind of talk to you guys about what it is an aerospace engineer does. The truth of the matter is we do a lot of different things. And within aerospace engineering, you can kind of break it up into sort of four different subdisciplines, and you end up typically focusing in one of these four subdisciplines. So the first one that I want to tell you guys about is a propulsion engineer. And so a propulsion engineer focuses on anything that's going to make a vehicle go. So I assume many of you drove here in a car today. You have a reciprocating engine in your car. We have aircraft that have reciprocating engines. As you guys know, aircraft can go much faster than cars. And if you need to go faster, then you might put a jet engine on your aircraft. And so if you've ever flown anywhere across the United States, you would have flown on an aircraft with a jet engine. If you need to go even faster and farther, then you start putting rocket engines on things. And so one of the best things about being an aerospace engineer is that, yes, indeed, rocket scientists are aerospace engineers. And so one of our fun things that we get to say to each other is, well, it didn't take a rocket scientist to figure it out. Oh, wait, it did. So that's one of the many perks of being an aerospace engineer. So this is our subdiscipline of working in propulsion. Next, what we have is a stability and control engineer. And basically what a stability and control engineer does is they come up with these mathematical models that describe how and why the aircraft is flying. And most importantly, they ensure that the aircraft doesn't just sort of fall out of the sky. Specifically, when an aircraft gets hit with a disturbance, so if you've ever flown on an aircraft and you've felt that turbulence, clearly since you're here today, the aircraft kept flying and it didn't just fall out of the sky because it got hit with this gust. Stability and control engineers are making sure that our aircraft are what we call stable. And so I have this video here. I apologize, it is actually a commercial for Mercedes-Benz, but it does an excellent job sort of illustrating this idea of dynamic stability of our vehicles. So if you don't mind, you can go ahead and play this video, and we'll watch and pay close attention to that chicken. Again, apologies for the Mercedes-Benz commercial. I don't endorse any sort of products in my presentations. But hopefully what you took away from that video is that chicken's body was being disturbed, right? And if you paid attention to its head, the chicken's head stayed, you know, straight and level, right? And so that's what a stability and control engineer is concerned about is, as we fly, we're going to have these disturbances, but we want to make sure that our aircraft is stable and it's staying on the path. And like I said, you know, if that chicken's head wasn't stable, it would be shaking all over, right, as you're shaking its body, but clearly it didn't. So that's a nice little example of sort of illustrating these concepts. And so if you click off the video, and we'll go forward. There we go. Now we can talk about our next subdiscipline in aerospace engineering. And that next subdiscipline is an aerodynamicist. And so aerodynamicists are concerned about how fluid moves over a body. And you might have heard me just say the word fluid. Air is considered a fluid. And so the physics that describe how, what you might have thought about when I said fluid, so water, how that moves over the a body, also govern how air flows over a body, and then the forces generated by that. And so the speed of that fluid might dictate sort of what field you could work in. And so you see an example up there of giant wind turbines. Again, I'm a Kansas girl, so for me, if I ever drive out to western Kansas, I'll see these giant wind turbines out there. Well, it turns out that the blades on those wind turbines look exactly like an aircraft's wing. They take on what we call an airfoil shape. So what an aerodynamicist might do if they worked in the wind energy business is that they might try to optimize that shape of that airfoil to try to maximize our forces that are acting on the blade, which then will maximize the energy output of our wind turbines. On sort of a other scale of what an aerodynamicist might do is if they're working with much higher speed aircraft, so we see a fighter aircraft up there, they can come up with the, again, sort of mathematical models that will predict how the fluid is flowing over the body so that we can predict things like lift and drag or shocks in the case of maybe a supersonic aircraft. Our last subdiscipline that we have in aerospace engineering is the best subdiscipline, in my opinion, because this is the subdiscipline I work in, but this is a structures and design engineer. And so what a structures and design engineer does, so part of it is in the name, we actually get to design those structures. So we create 3D models to illustrate the designs, we come up with manufacturing plans, and then we also have to analyze our designs to verify that they can withstand whatever loads that are being applied to them. And so maybe just to kind of give you an example of how my day-to-day sort of works is typically we get a set of requirements for some problem, right? I have a problem. I need a design to solve this problem. Here are some requirements. Now go design me something. So maybe to give you a real life example, I have two little girls at home, and so now my husband and I, we have to keep our cookies sort of on the top shelf of our pantry. Otherwise, my two little terrorists will dig into those. And so the problem for me is that the top shelf of my counter or my cabinet is just a little bit too tall for me. I can't get it. You know, if I was just maybe a few inches taller, then I could just get the cookies without, you know, too much ado. And so I have a problem, right? I can't reach my cookies. I'm a little too short. And so I might say, you know, if I could just be a couple inches taller, so if I had something that made me a couple inches taller, and then maybe something that I could put my size 8.5 feet on, then I would be able to easily reach my cookies. So as a design engineer, you might say, okay, well, I'll take those design requirements and I'll come up with a design and we'll build it for you and then you can go use it. So here is my high-tech design, my cookie reacher design. And so now I'm ready to go reach my cookies, right? So I clearly have not done my job well because my structure did not withstand the loads that I applied to it. So as a structural engineer, I have to now go back to the design board and say, okay, I need to analyze the loads that are also going to be applied to my structure. And so even though this design looks very similar, now we can test it out and see that, yes, it does meet my design requirements. It can withstand the load that I'm applying to it. And most importantly, I can reach my cookies, right? So that's just an overview of the different sorts of sub-disciplines that you can be in within aerospace engineering. And so now let's go back to how do you become an aerospace engineer. By and large, you have to go get a 4-year college degree. And for me, that meant attending the University of Kansas. So KU has an excellent aerospace engineering program. I got both my undergrad and my grad degrees there and left for a while and have now come back as faculty. And so one of the biggest parts about being successful in engineering is having a very strong math background. And so in high school, I would take calculus classes, as many advanced math classes as I could. And when I got to KU, even though I had taken as many advanced courses as I could, I still felt very unprepared compared to some of my colleagues who had gone to these larger schools, had all this college credit, and so on and so forth. And I even remember taking my very first exam in aerospace engineering and looking at that problem and totally blanking and thinking, I'm going to have to drop out of aerospace engineering after this. Luckily, I calmed down a little bit, took the exam, did very well, and now here I am. So yes, coursework in aerospace engineering is very difficult, but doing all that hard work in the classroom allows you to get to do really cool things outside of the classroom. So for me, I started looking for ways to get involved sort of in other activities outside the classroom. So one of the first things I did is I joined one of my professor's labs. And at the time, they were designing and building a 1,200-pound, what we call a UAV, or you guys are probably more familiar with the term drone. And so this drone is made out of very advanced aerospace composite material. And so as a sophomore in college, I got to start building this vehicle. It actually ended up being there for so long that I helped build the entire vehicle and eventually even seeing it flown. And so that was one activity I got to be involved in. Then there's lots of design competitions that you can partake in. And so this is an example of an aircraft I designed my senior year, and I submitted it for an international competition, and it won. And so this vehicle we didn't build, but you have to go through the entire design on paper and sort of submit this report. But other than some initial requirements, what you design and how you design it is completely up to you. And then last but not least, what I would say is probably the coolest thing I did while I was in college is I participated in a NASA program called Microgravity University. And what this program is as a student, you get to submit a proposal for an experiment that you want to conduct in microgravity. And then if you get accepted, then you get to go design your and build your experiment and then actually do it and conduct this experiment in microgravity. And so how do we create microgravity here on Earth? Clearly, the Earth doesn't take a break, take five, so we can all float around. Well, the way you do this is you have to fly on this aircraft that used to be called the Vomit Comet. And as you can imagine, that's not great for PR. And so they now call it the Weightless Wonder. But you get on this aircraft, and it flies these flight paths that are parabolas. And so hopefully we're somewhat familiar with parabolas, but if not, it kind of looks like, you know, a little hump like this. So what happens is you fly, and you start pulling up in the parabola, and as you do that, you actually experience 2G. And so 2G means you feel two times the force of gravity pulling on your body. And so as we stand here right now, or sit here, we're feeling 1G, one times the gravitational force pulling on our body. It's the reason we don't float around. It's the reason, unfortunately, we have weight, or that we register a weight on a scale. Like I said, as you're pulling up, you experience 2G. And if you wonder what that's like, it feels like your skin is being pulled off your bones. I distinctly remember sitting on the aircraft the very first time and just feeling like the skin from my neck was being sort of pulled down and sort of off me. It wasn't painful or anything, but it was sort of an odd sensation. So we're pulling up, we're feeling 2G, and then when you get to the top of the parabola, then you start heading down. And at this point, you're essentially in a free fall with the aircraft, but because you're inside the aircraft, you don't feel the wind blowing by you, and so you're essentially just floating around in the aircraft. And so that's what I'm doing there. I'm not super strong. I'm not holding myself up by one arm. I'm experiencing microgravity. And so you have about, I think it was, you know, somewhere between 30 seconds to a minute to experience microgravity and conduct your experiment. And so you do these series of parabolas, so you get these 30-second to 60-second segments where you can conduct your experiment. And since we're amongst friends here today, I feel okay telling you that the vomit comet earned its name from me that day. But luckily, I was able to get back up and keep going. So again, all of those extracurricular activities that I got to do as an aerospace student were because I worked really hard in the classroom, learning the fundamentals so I could go do those other things. And so when I got to the end of my sort of tenure, my undergraduate career at KU, you know, I'm thinking about what are my next steps. And I had really enjoyed the work that I had done in the research lab of my professor. So I decided that I was going to stick around and do grad school at KU. Well, as a graduate student, I got involved in this research center called the Center for Remote Sensing of Ice Sheets. And you might be thinking, what's an aerospace engineer doing around, hanging around a research center that's looking at ice sheets? Well, what we do, we call it CRESIS. So what we do at CRESIS is we design these custom radar systems that we integrate onto aircraft, and then we go fly those radar systems over polar regions. And what our radar systems do is that they take measurements of the ice sheets so that we can sort of understand them a little bit better, understand why they're changing as quickly as they are. And so it turns out that an ice sheet actually has layers. And in our radar data, you can see those layers in the ice sheet. And just like a tree has rings, and you can look at those rings and get some idea of how old the tree is, and maybe if you see a really dark ring, you would interpret that as maybe there was a forest fire that year. And so you can get some sort of history of that tree's life. Well, those layers in the ice sheet, we can do something similar for the history of the Earth. And so if you have a really thick layer, you would understand that to be, well, there was a lot of snow and accumulation that year. If you had a really thin layer, you would understand that to mean that you didn't have a lot of snow or an accumulation that year. And in fact, there's even a very dark layer in some portions of the ice sheets that is darker because it has a bunch of ash in it. And so scientists have determined thousands of years ago that there was a ginormous volcanic eruption because there was this layer of ash that's all across the ice sheet well below it. And so, again, what's an aerospace engineer doing around, hanging around folks looking at ice sheets? Well, like I said, we're putting these radar systems on aircraft, and in order to do that safely, you need an aerospace engineer. So I get to design a lot of the antenna systems, help integrate those onto the aircraft, and as you can see here, I won't play this video, but this is an example of one of the projects I worked on in grad school, and you might see that this is actually a NASA P3, So a lot of my work during my grad school years was funded by NASA, and I'm sure many of you, when you hear NASA, the first thing you think of is space exploration, but NASA funds a lot of projects in Earth science. They have an entire division that funds Earth science, trying to understand the planet that we live in. And so this is the NASA P3. Our antenna systems in the top right image there are those sort of brownish things hanging off the wings and under the belly. And then we also have some systems in the bomb bay sort of up front where it says accumulation and snow. And so if any of you are aviation enthusiasts, you might know that the P-3 was initially designed for the Navy, and it was a sub hunter. And so all those locations that we mount our sensors were actually where they used to mount bombs and torpedoes, but now they carry scientific instrumentation. So during my grad school years, I usually had the privilege of designing these systems, analyzing them, building them, getting them installed, and seeing them through flight test. But I never thought I'd have the opportunity to actually go down because sort of at that point, my skill sets weren't always needed to sort of support the mission, and I had to go back home and start working on the next one. But my last year in grad school, my advisor came to me and said, look, we've got a spot on our next mission. It was with the UAV that I helped build as an undergrad. And so I got my first opportunity to head down to Antarctica. And so here's a photo of our flight test team. We got our pilot out there, a couple of our other engineers with our 1,200-pound UAV. It was called the Meridian. And in the background there, you can see that is Mount Erebus. That is the southernmost active volcano in the world. And as you can see, there's a little puff of smoke up there. That thing is very much active. No large eruptions, but it's pretty much smoking the entire time that you're down there. So that's always in your background while you're down in Antarctica. So I get lots of people ask me, how do you get to Antarctica? Well, if we were going to leave from KCI today, what we would do is we would first probably fly to LA. From LA, we would fly down to New Zealand, and that travel from here down to New Zealand is typically about 19 hours, sort of nonstop travel for almost an entire day. And then once you get down to New Zealand, you'll spend a couple days there. And there's a base down there that the NSF has where you get some equipment, you kind of prep for going down. And then once you get to, then when it's time to go, then you can take somewhere between a 4 to 7 hour flight down to McMurdo Island, where the main U.S. base is. And the reason for that time differential in flights is just based on what aircraft you get and how quickly that, or how fast that airplane flies. My first year, I got to fly on a C-117, which as an aerospace engineer, I was nerding out about. But when you get there, you literally land on the ice shelf. So the ice is so thick there, you can land large aircraft on it, and that's what they use for their runways. And when you walk out of the aircraft, I have to tell you, it's probably the closest thing I'll ever feel to being on a different planet. Like, you walk out, and you might as well be on the moon. It's just white, maybe some mountains in the background, but just like down in your body, you can tell that you're in a very different place. So you get out of the aircraft and you kind of, you know, you're looking around, taking pictures, and then they quickly sort of shuffle you into this large bus. You can see it there. It's called Ivan the Terrabus. Those are full-grown adults putting their equipment or their bags under Ivan there. And so you can just see the size of that tire compared to those adults. This thing's a monster. The thing about this monster is it drives very slow. It's about 7 miles from the airfield to where the actual base is at, and it takes you about 40 minutes to make that trip. So, once you get there, like I said, the main base that most researchers go to is called McMurdo Station. This is actually a landing point for some of the historic polar explorations. So back in the early 1900s, when we still were trying to make it to the South Pole, McMurdo Island was where a lot of those expeditions started. And in fact, a lot of their huts are still there with all of their stuff. And you can actually go, and on certain days, they'll let you in there and see it. And all of their food and everything is still there. But as you can see, I would sort of describe McMurdo Station as sort of like a mining town. It's got this dark, gritty earth everywhere. It's actually, considering where you're at, it's quite comfortable. I don't know if I have a laser pointer on this thing. Oh, I kind of do. But that blue building right there, that's the galley. It's where you go and have your meals. And then just behind that, there's some brown buildings sort of back there. Those are dormitories. You usually have to share a room, but otherwise quite comfortable. There's even some office space, so for your science, so you can keep working while you're waiting. And so after you get to McMurdo, you usually then spend sort of the next week going through training before you actually get to go out in the field and do whatever it is that you're there to do. And so again, you're in this, even though there is some very comfortable digs there, you're still in this very extreme location. So one of my favorite trainings that you get to do is called Happy Camper. And basically this is just sort of a quick outdoor survival sort of training. And so things they show you is some of the basics. How do you set up a tent, a camp stove, that sort of thing. But then they sort of show you other things, like how do you build a snow fort, I shouldn't call it a fort, but a snow shelter, I should say, in case you get lost or stranded out in the Great White, what are you gonna do to survive? And so that's what I'm doing there on the right. I dug this giant hole and built a wall around it, and so that night I called it my snow chateau, but that night I got to spend the night in the ice in my snow chateau that I built. Also, it's not atypical that you're gonna need to use a snowmobile to get around while you're down there. And so you can see on the bottom image there, a couple of our snowmobiles. And so you have to get training, just, you know, basic safety, how do you operate it? And actually behind that image is our hangars, that where our aircraft was stored and where we spent most of our time. So after about a week of training, then you can finally do the thing that you're there to do. So like I said, for us, we were there to fly these UAVs. And in this image here, you see the big one over there on the right. That's the Meridian UAV. Those things hanging down from the wing are the antennas for our radar system that we operate. But then on your left, you also see a small little sort of RC aircraft. And so it turns out that a lot of the systems that we use for our big aircraft, say some of our autopilots, communication systems, guidance and navigation, we can first test out on smaller vehicles before we go test them out on our big vehicle. And just to give you some perspective, this small vehicle is about, you know, maybe $200. That big vehicle is about $2 million. And so as you can imagine, if something's gonna go wrong, we want it to go wrong on the $200 aircraft because we can buy another one of those. I don't know about you, but I know I certainly couldn't buy another $2 million aircraft in case something went wrong with that. But one of the things that makes it so difficult to work in these regions is, of course, the environment, but just sort of the level of planning that you have to go through. And so in that top image, what you see is that's me in the official polar gear. And pretty much any time you leave McMurdo, you have to take this gear with you. Whether you wear it or not, you have to take it with you. And in fact, I actually brought some here with me today. And I was actually hoping, I know this is sort of a smaller audience, but I was wondering if I could get a volunteer to come help model some of this for me. Do I have any brave volunteers? Yeah, how about you? Come on down here. What's your name?
Lily,
nice to meet you, Lily. You can stand right here. You may or may not need the chair. All right, so I have Lily here with me. So Lily, we're gonna go ahead and get your gear. So the first thing you might wanna get on is your long underwear, and so the NSF will give you used long underwear, but you probably don't want used long underwear, do you? Okay, let's skip that part. So we'll skip the used long underwear. But the next thing Lily probably wants to put on are her snow bibs. And so here are your snow bibs. We can see, I bet you could probably put these on without taking off your shoes. So Lily's putting on her snow bibs, and if you need to sit down, feel free. I don't want you to fall. Fantastic. Very form-fitting, aren't they? All right, perfect. Stand up and put your bibs on here. Awesome. Yep, nailed it. I got your size right, didn't I, Lily? All right, Lily, so you got your snow bibs on there. Next thing you're going to want is what we call Big Red. And so everywhere you go, Big Red has to go. And so here's your official NSF Antarctic jacket. And once again, I clearly nailed the size. So go ahead and put your Antarctic Big Red on. There we go, Lily. All right, you're looking great there, Lily. And so next, your feet. Your feet are going to get cold. And so you get what we call specialized bunny boots. And Lily, I talked to your guardian beforehand here, and they assured me that this was your shoe size. So I think I am now wondering if that was the right person I talked to. But these, if you want to go ahead and put your bunny boots on, these are specialized boots that are extra warm, because it turns out that the ice in Antarctica is actually colder than the ice we get here. It actually gets well below freezing. And so the ice here in Kansas, you know, it's usually around freezing or so. But these are specially made for polar regions. And in fact, oftentimes, there's actually little vents on the side, because oftentimes, more often than not, your feet actually get too hot, and you kind of have to cool off and open up those vents. All right, Lily, next. We got to protect that noggin of yours. Got to keep that warm. So let's put our balaclava on. All right. Very good. And then one thing people don't think of a lot is it's very bright, right? So when the sun is out in Antarctica, it reflects off the white snow, and that white snow reflects a lot more light than, say, a dark ground. And snow blindness is a real issue, and so you always have to have some sort of eye protection. So let's put our goggles on there, Lily. Very good. All right, we got those peepers protected. Good job. Okay. Last but not least, gotta keep those digits protected. You actually can start getting frostbite with exposed skin in less than 5 minutes. And so it's always important to keep your fingers warm. And Lily, I brought you the most efficient gloves I could. So here are your polar gloves. Very nice. All right, you ready to work, Lily? Okay, well, I brought my UAV here. We're getting it ready to go fly. So the first thing we need to do, Lily, if you can, we got to get this wing on this spar here. So here, I'm going to give you this wing. There you go. Perfect. And what you're going to try to do is you're going to try to slide it onto this tube right here. The aircraft's over here, Lily. There you go. There you go. Look at you. Well, that's a square hole that you're trying to put a round peg into. Oh, there. Oh. Okay, Lily, there's a C-130 coming in. We got to hurry. We only have about 30 minutes of time for flight. Lily, come on. Okay, forget it, Lily. I'll take care of that later. Okay, there's actually some servos on the back here that we need to fix. And so if you can go get the tools and the screwdriver, we can fix. Lily, where are the tools? Did you forget to pack them, Lily? Do you think there's an Ace Hardware down the street, Lily? Okay, all right. Well, seems like we came very unprepared for our mission today. And so, Lily, thank you very much for being my guinea pig. You can go ahead, and I'll quit harassing you. And if you want to go ahead and take off your polar gear here, can you guys give me a round of applause here for Lily? And so as Lily's taking off her polar gear, the point I was trying to make there, which is hopefully obvious, you know, the amount of planning that we have to do to go to these regions is immense. Everything down from as simple as a screwdriver to any sort of specialized equipment, you can just throw it there. You got to make sure you have to pack it, and oftentimes you have to pack and send this stuff well in advance. So we typically have to ship stuff 4 months before we actually go down to polar regions. And so it's very difficult to sort of do all that planning. Thank you, Lily. Yeah. That was my first experience down in Antarctica. We flew that drone. I actually got another opportunity a few years later to go back down. This time I got to go on a manned aircraft. And so here you see, it's technically a Basler BT-67. It's actually got the airframe of a DC-3, which again, if any of you are aviation enthusiasts, you know that this is a very famous aircraft. And actually the original airframe of this very aircraft was actually manufactured back during World War II. So that is another very unique thing about being an aerospace engineer. The things we design, fly, and operate for well beyond many other disciplines. I'm sure many of you don't own an 80-year-old car, but we still fly aircraft that are very old. And of course, it's gone through some refurbishments. In that image there, you can see our sensor is sort of hanging down between those two tires. And so this experience was very different for me because I actually got to be on the aircraft and fly around to all these different parts of Antarctica. So if you want to hit play on the video, this is actually a video of us flying over what's called Bird Glacier. It's Bird with actually a Y. It's named after someone. But what you see there is this very rough surface there, and so that's the glacier. And as the camera sort of scans across here, you'll see it's much smoother. That's the edge of the glacier. And then I think at some point I'll go the other way and you'll look at the other edge. But I'm sure many of you have heard of the word glacier, but what exactly is a glacier? It's essentially a river of ice. So it's the way that ice from the center of the continent moves to the ocean. And the reason this surface is so rough is because that ice is actually flowing. Now, granted, you can't throw a penny out there and then watch it float by you. It's moving very slow, on the order of maybe, I think it's like maybe kilometers or maybe even meters per year, depending on which glacier it is. But that sort of gives you a sense of the types of things that we're flying over. And one of our missions for this particular year actually took me all the way down to the South Pole. And so the idea for this mission was there were some surveys that we wanted to do around the South Pole. Well, the vehicle doesn't carry enough fuel, so we flew down to the South Pole, actually landed, took a pit stop, if you will, refueled, and then got back up and completed our survey and flew home. And so this morning, I'm sure some of you took a pit stop at Quick Trip or something as you came in to get some fuel. It's a little bit different than that. Probably fuel is closer to $400 or $500 a gallon down at the South Pole, so thank your stars, you didn't pay that much. And so I had about an hour on the ground, which after being in the South Pole, I've decided that's about the right amount of time that you want to spend at the South Pole. Because if you look behind me, that's South Pole Station, that big metal building, and that's pretty much all there is there. And so I got out, I remember getting out of the aircraft, and it was a balmy summer day. It was about negative 25 degrees Fahrenheit. During the winters, it definitely can get down to negative 200. I remember after a little bit, I remember my nose hairs, I could feel them just like freezing, and like anything that was exposed, I was quickly covering up. And so I ran over, there's a couple monuments there, one for the geographic South Pole, and then there's also one for the magnetic South Pole down there. And so I got out, took my pictures, and I made sure to make it back to the aircraft, because as we got out of the aircraft to take our pit stop, our pilot says, if you are not here by the time I'm ready to leave, I will leave you. And so I was very sure that I got back to the aircraft. And so I'm hoping in the next few years I'll get another opportunity. We have several missions. Actually, this last year, we had folks down at the South Pole for about a month. There's a current mission going on that they're trying to find the oldest ice ever. And so if you have the oldest ice, then you can have a full sort of history of the Earth. I've also more recently gone the other direction. So 2 years ago, I got to go up to Greenland. And so oftentimes when you hear folks talk about Arctic science, Greenland is a big place for that. Further north, to the North Pole, if you don't know, there's no land at the North Pole. It's just water, and so that freezes, and you can get sea ice. But we went down to, or we went up, I guess, to Greenland 2 years ago, and we got to camp on the side of this glacier called Helheim. And Helheim translates to hell. And so if you thought maybe it would be a great idea to go to a glacier that's named after hell, it actually wasn't that bad there. And so this is a picture of Helheim. You can see sort of that rough ice again. And this time around, what we were there to do is test out much smaller vehicles. So this is my helicopter drone that I have, that big thing, that disky thing on the bottom that's part of our radar system. But our goal here is to see if we can miniaturize these systems. Because if we can miniaturize them, they're less expensive, more people can use them, and so instead of having to have a group of engineers go out every time, maybe the scientists can just take this vehicle and operate it themselves. And so that's one of the vehicles we were operating while we were out there. The environment was very different than Antarctica. I have a little video here, I think, of our camp. And so this is our camp right here. Those are where we slept. We each got our own tent. It was very comfortable. And you may have noticed there's a little bit of dust that came up there. That terrain there is this really, really, really fine silt dust, sort of like moon dust. And it just got over everything and everywhere. And I think, so here we go. This is actually our kitchen right here. As you can see, just like at home, I don't keep my kitchen very clean. But that's all of our food that we had with us that day. or I guess those 2 weeks. There's our little camp stove for making water for coffee. And you might notice that fence that is sort of around the kitchen there. And that's actually a bear fence. And so when you work in Arctic regions, polar bears are actually a real concern there. And so you need to bring a bear fence to put around your food on the off case that you encounter one. You are also legally obligated to carry a rifle with you when you are in Arctic regions for the fact that there are polar bears. Now, definitely it is not your intent to harm a polar bear because you are in their home, but if you ever encounter a polar bear where your nearest help is maybe, you know, an hour-long helicopter ride away, you want to make sure you have your bases covered. So that right there, you can see that person. There was a couple other people up on the hill. That was me. And then we brought along with us two students, and one other faculty member was there. And you can see that's our helicopter UAV coming in there. And it's coming in for a landing. We have our yellow science tent there. So that's basically our laboratory, if you will, where we would work on our equipment. That's where we would store it at night. And so here we are coming in for a landing. Here is just this is just gonna be sort of a survey of what the glacier looks like. And so on the left, that's the front of the glacier. So on the left where it looks smooth, this is where the ice is broken off and it's now floating on water, whereas to the right, it's still technically attached to the ground, but it is still moving. And so in a bit here, we'll maybe take a little bit of a view, and maybe since the video is sort of struggling here, if you want to click forward maybe just a little bit on the time scale, and maybe we'll just get a little view of what the glacier sort of looks like. This was supposed to be just a little survey. I think here in a bit you'll get a better view of sort of what the crevices look like, and maybe skip forward just a little bit more if you can, and we'll get a top view of the aircraft. We'll see if it shows up here. Well, we might just have to skip. Let's just skip this video, and maybe we'll get it to work later. But so that's just supposed to kind of give you an idea of sort of what our working conditions were like. That glacier is very rough, and so if we'd seen some of those videos, what we would have seen is that there are very deep crevices in the ice, and so many of those crevices go hundreds of meters down. And so this is why we need aircraft to do these missions. There's no way you would survive sort of trying to cross that by foot. So there are sled-based systems, but if you fell down one of those crevices, you're not coming back. And so this is why we need aircraft to fly these radar systems, is because it's not safe to sort of traverse them any other way. And so while we were there, hopefully this video will work, while you're there, the entire time the glacier will just kind of pop. And that's just the ice breaking off. And so you just, you know, you'll hear a couple pops here and there. And then one time when we were flying a mission, all of a sudden we heard this popping and it didn't stop and it started getting louder. And we looked out on the ice and all of a sudden we saw this huge chunk of the ice just start to raise up. It was sort of like watching, like it looked like a transformer or something, just like emerging from the earth. And so what's happening in this video is we are witnessing a calving event, or what we call a calving event. And what calving is when large chunks of ice break off the glacier, and then what they do is they roll over onto their side, and then they become icebergs. So if you've ever been in a polar region or somewhere where it's very cold water and you see an iceberg, you're actually looking at the side of the ice because it's flipped over and it's floating on its side. And so this is a massive chunk of ice that just while we were there just started breaking off. And so I know there's another video. We'll see if maybe that one works a little bit better here. But while this was happening, we suddenly, like, we landed our vehicles and then got our video drone up, and we actually got to fly. We were flying through this calving event, sort of capturing, you know, this thing happening in real time, and just massive amounts of massive ice just, like, breaking off, just roiling and boiling. It was probably, I tell people, this is probably the most awesome and terrifying thing I've ever witnessed in my entire life. And just within about an hour, what we saw was about a half of a kilometer of ice just break off of this ice, this glacier, and become an iceberg. And so the reason I like to show these is, especially for me, this was a good reminder of why we are doing the work that we're doing. In an hour, I saw this massive change in this glacier due to our warming climate and climate change. And so it really brought home to me just really how critical the work that we're doing is in supporting this science mission. And so with that, that's really all I have for you guys today. Hopefully, you know, something I said today you at least found at least a little bit interesting or exciting. And maybe before I leave you, I don't know if we have time for questions. I usually talk way too long. But the thing I also want to leave you guys with is the coolest things I've ever done in my life is because I decided to be an engineer. And so without that, I'm sure I would have done some interesting things, but nothing like the things that I've got to experience. So with that, thank you so much for your time, for being here on a Saturday morning to hear a science lecture. So I appreciate you all being here. And with that, I don't know if we have time for questions, or I might turn it back to Emily. Okay, do we have any questions? Yeah, go ahead. Ooh, good question. The question is, do I have a favorite aircraft? And this might be an odd one, but my favorite one is actually a Twin Otter. And if you don't know what a Twin Otter is, it's a dual engine, turboprop engine aircraft. And the reason I they're not high speed at all, but the reason I like them is that they're considered a bush aircraft, and so you can land and take off from unimproved runways. And so when you go to Antarctica, there's basically two aircraft that get operated. It's the Twin Otter and then the basically the DC-3. And so I guess there's some C-130s and some other ones, but those Twin Otters can take you places that no other aircraft can. And so for me, I love that sort of like, we could hop on here and go almost anywhere. So for me, it's the Twin Otter. What is the hardest part about being an aerospace engineer? Probably when things don't work. And so that's anytime you do an experiment or you're using hardware and things don't work, there's no like user guide to tell you why it's not working. So as an engineer, it's wholly up to you to figure out, why is this not working? You know, what is going on here? What are the physics that are preventing this from working? And so those problems to solve, sometimes you'll figure it out in a day, sometimes you'll figure it out in a month, sometimes it takes you an entire year to figure out why things aren't working the way you think. And so you have to have that patience and perseverance to figure it out, because if you don't, like I said, there's probably not anyone else there that is gonna answer that question for you. So good question. Any other questions? Yeah, good question. So the question is, when we did the microgravity, each time we went down, was that sort of a reset of the experiment? For us, it was. There were some other experiments there that might have been able to run continuously, but really the data that you cared about was when you were in the free fall. And I should also have mentioned that based on their rate of descent, you can actually simulate Martian gravity, which is about one-third of what it is here on Earth, and you can also simulate lunar gravity, which is about one-tenth. And so based on controlling that rate of decline, you can also simulate other microgravity climates. And I'm also glad that you asked about that experiment, because there was a gal who was maybe 3 years ahead of me in the aerospace program, and she was one of the first ones to do that microgravity experiment out of KU and kind of created a club. Actually got to talk with her yesterday. Her name is Laurel O'Hare, and she's actually on the ISS right now. And so we had an event at KU where we actually got to connect with her for about 30 minutes, because that's about how long we had connectivity with her. But she also sort of kickstarted that microgravity club at KU and is now an astronaut and currently on the ISS. So that was, for me, that was pretty a highlight of my Friday yesterday, as I got to talk with an astronaut. Other questions? Yeah.
How much coding work would you
Yeah, the question is, how much coding work do we do? Maybe I'll answer you with every engineer needs to know how to code. And you know, I get a wide range of students that come in, some that have lots of coding experience, some that have none. And that's okay, either way you come in, because we offer classes and training. But every engineer needs to know how to code. There's lots of different languages out there. But I would say that's sort of a core skill set that an engineer would have is coding. Oh, that's a good question. We're getting technical here. So the language, usually it's MATLAB, but Python is more dominating. I mean, for an aerospace engineer, we don't necessarily always develop apps and things like that. And so we primarily use R codes for just the computational power running of simulations and models and that sort of thing. So our two biggest ones, I'd say, are MATLAB and Python. But I will tell you, when we teach coding, really the idea is that you would sort of be language agnostic. So what we try to emphasize at an undergraduate level is just the fundamentals of coding, with the idea that you could then take that and learn whatever language that you need to in your career. Any other questions? Sure. Good question. So that one, sort of the question is, I'll sort of summarize, what exactly are we looking at with our radars? And so we look at a lot of things. So if I went back to that cartoon, you'll see that we had I had a couple different beams coming out and different frequencies. And so we do a lot of different missions. We have a lot of different intents with what we're trying to measure. And so some of our systems actually only measure the depth of snow. And so you can see the snow on where the snow and air interfaces, and then the snow and ice interfaces. So some scientists are interested in how much snow is on top of the ice. Others are interested in what's going on with those layers very close to the surface. And then one of our big measurements that we do, like I mentioned, is measuring all the way down to the bedrock. And so there's a lot of interest in what the bedrock looks like. What is the condition of the bedrock, meaning is it wet down there or is it dry? And then also just in general, the depth. And so the reason that bedrock is so important to scientists is that they can take what that bedrock looks like and then they put it in their models and they actually run simulations to try to simulate, okay, well, if we have this much heating in the future, what do we expect these glaciers to do? Are they going to continue to sort of recede? Is there any potential that they might increase in size? And so there's also glaciers that move very, very fast, and we don't understand why they're moving very fast, because then there's glaciers right next to them that are moving very slow. And so the way that bedrock looks, if you imagine if it's very, very rough, the glacier doesn't move as fast. So if you can imagine, right, maybe if I sprinted across this stage is very smooth. So if the bedrock of the glacier is very smooth, we would expect that glacier to move very fast because there's nothing sort of impeding its motion. If instead I took all this junk I have here on the floor and I put it in my way and maybe got some more stuff and made this surface really rough and now I had to run across, well, now I'm going to move a lot slower, right? Because I got to get over all that stuff and I got to move over, and so I'm going to move slower. And so what that bedrock, again, could tell scientists is, why is this glacier moving so fast or why is it moving so slow? You asked specifically about permafrost. So permafrost is just basically frozen soil. You see it a lot in Arctic regions. We haven't used our radars a lot for those types of measurements. It's a very different type of measurement. It's an area that we're interested in, but it sort of takes a specialist to sort of understand what those returns mean. Maybe the last measurement I'll also kind of mention is we measure sea ice. And so up in the northern latitudes, like I mentioned, there's no rock or there's no ground at the North Pole. It's just water. But you get sea ice. And the sea ice extent has been decreasing and decreasing and decreasing because of climate change. And it's now to the point where there's a lot of military interest in how these Arctic conditions are changing, because we're to the point where previously you could not, during certain months, you could not sail a ship or take a ship from one end of Russia to the other. But now because that sea ice has declined and there's no ice blocking ships, they can do that now. And so there's lots of interest in now also not military, but also just sort of shipping in general. You know, can we navigate what we call the new Arctic? So we also do a lot of measurements with sea ice and trying to understand the changes there as well. Any other questions? All right, well, if not, again, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it. And again, I hope maybe I said something today that was of interest to you. And as I clean up, if you have any other questions that you want to come ask, feel free to come on down here. But thank you.